many of you guys, by show of hands, were at Moltec last week? Okay. So, a couple ahas I got. This was like two things I learned in this work. You know, the whatever 8 hours it was being there. The average American's attention span is 9 seconds, right? So then, poor Chad, he had to keep walking around like this, right? So I'm going to be doing the same. And then, realtor's average time span is what?
5 seconds.
So that was the first one. It's actually 9 seconds. Emma, stop walking around. I'm gonna get tired. Second thing is the rule of thirds. You remember that?
Yes.
So who can tell me the rule of thirds?
Place yourself in one third of the picture when you're taking a photo.
Okay. Moving in the background. Like a plant.
Right.
Train, cars.
Dog.
Okay. That was pretty cool. So from now on, any video you see me doing, I'm going to have something moving. Right, so Zach may be dancing in the background.
I'm always dancing in the background.
Zach's been practicing his Gangnam thing. Okay. So
let's see.
You missed
just
it.
Just gonna go off. You know, last week, I know we talked about inventory and you know how things are tight and when's it gonna pass and get better. So interesting. It's just looking at. I was just talking to a big Fannie Mae broker. And I was asking him this morning over that SCR how busy it was, and he's just like, hey, it's crazy. We have like 70 right now, and you know, only like about 15 active. You know, they're the biggest Fannie Mae broker right now, and it's just nuts, right? And things are just flying as they come in, right? And the problem we're seeing is we don't have enough inventory to sell, right? So when you look at 2011, just some stats on listings published, it was 17% change, so down from last year, right? So 1,708 in December 2011, and last year, you know, 2,065, so 17% decrease in inventory, right? Now you look at end of 2012, 34% decrease, so it's like double. And then you look at REO for 2012, okay? Down 71%, right? Short sales up 24%. You look at 2011, REOs were down 14%, right? Compared to 71%, that's a big jump, right? What's 71 minus 14? Very quickly, 71 minus 14. Yes. Okay. 57. That's a big difference, okay? You want to do math? Okay. Short sales in 2011 increased 44%, right? And then we're looking at this year, or last year, 2012, 24%, right? Conventional sales, 18% increase, end of 2012. And what other interesting number do I see here? So I don't think, you know, because, you know, 2012, down 34% inventory, I don't think it's going to double. That's going to be crazy. You know, Mark?
Yes.
What do you think is going to happen? What do you feel right now? How do you feel this year? I mean, okay. I talked to you the other day, and you said you were looked like you were just walking on water. Like
it's the vodka.
Yeah. You
got to read
this. Right. And then I saw Tom the other day. He got a really big listing. But what are you seeing right now?
I'm seeing the traditional sales coming back.
Okay.
Yeah.
Like normal people.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. And then I talked to some folks that are doing a lot of, you know, prospecting, door knocking, expires, Facebooks. And what I'm hearing is, yeah, I got a bunch of folks on the fence of listing, but they just don't want to wait till, you know, spring, or, you know, wait till prices go up. Is what have we been seeing on the news lately? It's been crazy. Like, I've seen it everywhere, like on CNN, on websites, just
the predictions of the increase. Absolutely.
Right. So now, you know, they've talked enough about it going down, now it's going up. And then now you're starting to see like new stories like real estate, housing is going to be a key, you know, key component of the recovery, right? So I think it's all right here, you know.
Yeah.
All consumer confidence, right?
Absolutely.
So now, you know, the cash buyers, the investors, everybody's just wanting to get properties. Just when are we going to get them, right?
We are getting them. Let's think. Let's talk that way.
Yeah.
Well, we are getting them, but then the ones that are still actively prospecting, you know, in the business, because there's 5,000 realtors right now. Last I looked, in our MLS, right? I don't think a lot of them are going to be around because, you know, they're not going to hang in there like us. So those that hang in there are going to reap the benefits.
Can I say something to that real quick?
Yes, sir.
Just will kind of sum it up if I hear what you're saying. I spoke to an agent that's been in the business for less than 2 years, and he goes, my first year I closed 12 deals. Not too bad, first year in the business. He goes, last year I closed 4.
Okay.
I go, do you do any listings? He goes, 0. So I'm like, well, if you change that, because you're only working with buyers, that's all he's doing. So
right.
In this market, if all you're doing is only working with buyers, so I think if we're all actively looking to prospect listing focused, which we are, you know, that's kind of how the market changes for the better.
And is this Jenna Moe Keller Williams?
No.
Should be checking out some more classes. Okay, so does he need a
Disney.
All right, so we're going to go through our paydays right now. So our last team meeting, so now we have 16 paydays. Woohoo! See all that energy?
Woohoo!
Come on, guys. So, Zach. G-Man.
Payday.
Jennifer Carroll. Logan Durham team. Elizabeth Harrell. Aaron Lee. Lichtenberg team. Loudon team. McElvin team. Angelo Mendez, Terry Mao, Judy Ramirez, Tracy Saison, Joy Yip. Nice. Our events here are a little light because we are having a family reunion in February. So boot camp is going to be happening February 6th to 8th. Zach's got it coordinated. We have a lot of vendors, a lot of different folks coming in to set up for that. So if you want to talk about that a little bit?
Sure. Boot camp is designed to propel anybody into the real estate industry, to teach you exactly from start to finish the whole transaction and the whole business. We've got lenders talking about lending, and we've got home inspectors talking about home inspectors. We have team leaders talking about real estate. And so those of you that are newer to the industry, this is going to be priceless training.
And the difference with this at Ignite is more the technicals, like here's actual disclosures, you know,
prelim,
right, purchase contract. In Ignite, we talk about that, doing the transaction from A to Z. However, Ignite's more prospecting, more lead generation, right? This is more on the technical side of the contract and all the reports and things like that. Fun stuff, right? Okay. Technology Masterminds. This, I heard, is open now.
Woo-hoo.
For anybody to attend.
It's always open. It's once a month.
Once a month.
Well, we're gonna. If you were at Bold Tech, you should be there because we're going to be breaking down everything at Bold Tech over the course of the next few months. If you were not at Bold Tech and you missed it, you should be there so that you can pick up nuggets of what we all learned at Bold Tech. So you don't have to be really techie to come to it. We have several people in it last time that weren't real techie that I never got great information out of it.
And you guys, it looks like you guys had a lot of different folks from a lot of different areas coming, so it wasn't just folks in here that you see every day, so you get different insight.
Yep.
So it was pretty awesome.
While I'm talking, can I mention one thing? The next day, the SAR Master Club Roundtables is the next day, and I guess I'm going to be speaking at it on social media. So, roundtables, if you're not familiar with it, are there's eight different topics that are covered. So, look at your newsletter that comes out from SAR and sign up to go to it. That was a great event.
Okay. That's on Friday.
Yes, the next day, February 8th.
Okay. And then we have our next team meeting, branding and farming. Scott
Ostro.
I believe he's from
Ostro.
Okay. Folsom, right?
Yep.
Okay.
He's got like I think 3 or 4 multi-million-dollar listings, and he's just picked up about 4 or 5 other listings from the farming and expireds he's doing, so very sharp guy.
Didn't he recently switch his business? He had a pretty low price point a couple years ago, isn't that his story?
Yes. Yes, he intentionally started going towards a higher price point. So,
that'd be kind of nice to hear.
Yes.
Right? I hear a lot of folks, but hey, I'm just wanting to focus on a particular price point. So, this would be good insight. All right? That's also on, well, that's on the 6th. Okay. Continue. All right. So, next item here. December profit share. We're going to be distributing some profit share. We had a good December profit, okay? And some of our top earners and those that are here, come on up and I'm going to give you guys your profit share. So I see the first person I see here is Yudi.
I was just looking at that.
And oh, you got it? How'd you get it?
It was in my dump box.
Yeah, oh, okay. John?
I gave
it
to everybody.
John Nastro, go up and get your check.
$713.
Wait, do you actually have a check for me?
Pretty nice.
Lori Mode? Yeah. Lori Mode?
There you
go. Congratulations. I am free for lunch today, by the way. Tom Littmer here. Chris.
Okay.
Bruce. You can give this to Bruce. Melinda DeMain. Oh, Mindy DeMain. So that's why you changed the name.
Yes.
Kevin Cooper and Samantha Cooper.
No.
Not here.
They're all right.
Oh, okay. Okay. All right, so congratulations. I'd like to see this every single month. And spotlight vendor today, Zach.
Was it being switched?
Independent home inspections.
Okay, and they are not here. So we're going to get them off.
He wasn't able to make it, but we still wanted to recognize him as
okay, so we're gonna go into our.
There was a quick.
Yeah.
Nancy, you're up.
Oh, okay, great, great. Hi, everybody. I'm Nancy Milton. I'm an attorney mediator and I'm a guest of business today. Hi, Mark. And I'm here just to let you know about a community event that we're having. I'm part of the Laguna Sunrise Rotary. We have our taste event in April, if you're familiar with that, and would like tickets to that. But we're also having a Peace Through Understanding Forum in March. Okay, the Rotary theme this year is Peace Through Service. And this is a community-wide event at Laguna Creek High School Multipurpose Room. We have the mayor, the vice mayor, the police chief. We have somebody from the hate crime division, Superintendent Steve Ladd, our Multicultural Community Youth Commission. We're going to talk about peace on the local level, regional. It's just a community-wide event, and I wanted to let you know about it. I have flyers that Chris bought. Okay? Thank you so much.
Thank you.
I'm going to have Mr. Saison here so that we can introduce our guest speaker today.
Sweet. Before I do that, my mother gave me this, I let her borrow it, but remember the Paul Thorne? He's playing at Harlow tonight. If you're a mega agent, you saw him. It's pretty cool that he's going to be in our hometown playing tonight.
And we're trying to get
get a group of people to go.
Yes, and we're going to
support him.
No, we're not interested. We already got it. Yeah.
Yeah, that's right. It's done.
We are going to Harlow's tonight. We will see you there. Make sure you're not inappropriate on your best behavior.
So you're not going to be there.
So everybody, for the most part, I would imagine everybody knows Kevin Bracey. I met him in 2007 when my mother was president of SAR, and that's how I got to meet him. Phenomenal man, phenomenal person, mentor, love the guy tremendously. So I would imagine most of you saw the video that went out, and today's going to be pretty special because he's going to get us all interacting, and hopefully you guys got some questions that you want to ask him. And I just want to just... it's not in our hands, it's not a trophy, but we are presenting you for all of the graciousness that you have given. A lot of agents, we've already kind of had a little huddle earlier, and then we spoke to three different businesses, and they agreed to be a sponsor, so you will have a check in hand in 2 weeks that we are buying a lump sum of 50 tickets to Monstars and Motivation. So that's our gift to you. So without further ado, Kevin Bracey.
How you doing?
Great.
Five, say yes.
Yes.
Eat this after me, please. I feel good.
I feel good.
I feel great.
I feel great.
I'm ready to learn more.
Like
this with me, so I can earn more. I find somebody to your right, your left, and say, brace yourself.
Brace yourself.
You know, I think I've been coming to Keller Williams since Mindy. What was that year? The first year that I came. Do you remember that year?
Probably 2007.
And I met, you know, obviously was connected to Keller through the Saisons, who I love so much, my family. And many times when I come, I have this prepared speech already to fill this room with energy and ideas and strategies of how you can do more, be more, have more. But I wanted to do it a little bit differently today because, you know, I can put together a talk. And my gift is to motivate and inspire. That's just what I do. I just come from that space. That's just what I believe I've been made to do with my life. But I wanted to make it a little bit more specific and a little more personal, kind of calm down the energy and just have some conversations because everybody here has different challenges, struggles, things that happen on a day-to-day basis. So who has not heard me speak before? Okay, you're off the hook. Who has heard me speak before? Okay, who saw the video? You sit down, okay, a few of you, okay. What I wanted to do today is to have you think of a question, because you guys have heard me speak, so you know kind of what I do. But I wanted you to come here with a question that you'd like to ask me. And I was thinking about coming here today to tell my story because I believe if I told my story, see, you know me as a motivational speaker, I come in excited, I'm positive and all that, but I didn't come from that. Come from something totally different, the opposite. You would probably be surprised to know it. But I didn't want to go that dark on you today. I wanted to keep it a little bright, you know? But I wanted you to come up with a question that you would like to ask me in terms of maybe how to keep build your self-confidence, how to stay on the positive side of life. What do you do when you go down into the doldrums? How many go down into the doldrums sometimes? How do you pick yourself? You know, so it's an open forum, but before we go there, let me share my disclaimer. I am 40 years young. And I'm not gonna sit up here today and talk to you from a space as if I feel like I know it all. Because I make a conscious effort to try to learn something every single day, add to my body of knowledge every single day. So I'm not necessarily asking you today to believe everything that I say, do everything that I say, agree with everything that I say. I'm not asking you to do that. But what I am going to do is, as you ask me questions, I'm going to give you honest answers based upon your question. I may not be able to answer everybody's question. I may have to throw it to somebody else in the room, and we kind of throw it around and talk about it. But if you find something in the ideas that I might share that you feel that can work for you, that you can implement into your personal life, that you can implement into your professional life, that you can implement maybe into your spiritual life, then I say use it. If not, that's cool. Push it aside and leave it for someone else. If that's fair, say that's fair enough.
That's fair enough.
See, I start off before we go into questions. The premise, what I believe every day when I wake up, and I've grown to this belief. Okay, this wasn't how I always believed. I've grown to this. I personally believe that everybody in this room who can hear the sound of my voice this morning, that you have something special. I believe that there's greatness in you. That's just where I come from. I come from that space that there's greatness in all of us. Now, I don't say that to be kind, to be courteous, because I'm supposed to say that because I'm a motivator. I don't say it for you to like me. Oh, he's so nice. That's not why I say it. I say it because it's true. And when I say you have greatness within you, I now have four definitions of greatness. Definition number one, repeat this after me, please. Best effort.
Best effort.
See, I believe that when you're giving your best effort at what you do, whether it be on the phone, whether it be sending an email, whether it be face-to-face with a client, whether it be sitting down with one of your colleagues and having conversation, I believe that when you're giving your best effort, your workout this morning, I know I just taught a class, when I'm teaching classes, I try to give my best effort right now as I'm sitting before you. I'm giving you my best effort, my undivided attention. I believe that when you're giving your best effort at what you do, that is your greatness. We all have greatness within us. Second definition of greatness. Repeat this after me, please. The best version of me.
Of me.
See, I believe that when you're giving the best version of who you are as a human being, that is your greatness. So when I say you have greatness within you, it's not just this phrase that I'm using. There's some definitions that I've identified since the last time we talked. The best version of you as a human being is your greatness. How many know that we all have a best version? So when I say you have greatness, I'm not just saying it, throwing it out there flippantly. I believe that. Let me give you an example. Not too long ago, I was at Natomas. I think there was a Safeway over there in Natomas. And I was coming out. I just bought a sandwich. And I was coming out of the parking lot. I was rushing to my next appointment. And I had my food on my lap. I was distracted driving. And my apologies. But I was hungry. I was going to pass out if I didn't get some food in me. Can anybody relate? So I was looking left as the cars were coming because I needed to make a right turn. As I was looking left, I saw that there were no cars coming. So I automatically was going to turn right and look in the direction in which I was turning. As I peeked right, there was a couple there with a dog that had a sign that said, "We'll work for food. Can you help?" Now, I'm about to bite the sandwich. I'm literally about to bite into this sandwich. And at the moment, it was so fast that I can't even really say I thought about it. It was just a reaction. I thought to myself, they need this more than I need this. So I just, not even thinking, I rolled the window down. I put that sandwich that I was about to bite back into the wrapper. I packaged it up, and I gave it to that couple. Because I knew they needed it more than me. Now, I don't say that to put myself on a pedestal. But in that moment, that was the best version of me. Does that make sense? Your great, that was my greatness right there. The best version of you is your greatness. Repeat this after me, please. There's greatness.
In me.
Third definition of greatness is your best talent. What you do best inside of the framework of what you do every day. I mean, no, there's many things that you do every day in order to grow your business. What is the thing that you do best? What's your best talent? We all have a talent, skill. For me, as a speaker, I've got to market, I've got to send out emails, I've got to network, there's a whole bunch of things that I do within my business as a professional communicator. But the thing that I do best is what I'm doing right now. This is my best talent. All that other stuff is just stuff that I have to do. So identifying what you do best and giving that thing that you do best along with those other things, your very best effort. Your best talent in what you do is your greatness. Repeat this after me, please. There's greatness.
There's greatness.
In me.
In me.
Fourth definition of greatness is when you become or when you desire to become the very best at what you do. You're not okay with being third. You're not okay with being fifth. You have a desire, just the desire alone to be the very best at what you do, I believe is your greatness. So when I say there is greatness in you, so there's somebody right now as I'm saying that, you're rejecting it right now. You don't want to receive it. I don't know why. I didn't receive it for a lot of years. I had to grow to it and say it to myself over and over and over again in order to believe it. And once I began to believe it is when I could give that kind of stuff away to other people, because I think that's really what it's all about, is knowing that there's greatness within you, but every day that we live, living selflessly and giving that type of energy and love and smile to other people. Does that make sense to you? Repeat this after me, please. There's greatness.
There's greatness.
In me.
In me.
Questions. Start with questions.
I'll start.
My favorite person.
So, for someone like me.
Yes.
Older.
Wiser.
Been in the business for, 32 years. How can you help me to wake up every morning and still feel enthusiastic and excited about this business every day?
Wow, that's a great question. right away, the first thing that I think is, I believe that no matter how long we do something, I think that it's imperative to get connected to our reason for doing it. But it can't just be, oh, my reason. No, it's got to be something that's profound in you. What is your reason for getting up every day to do what it is that you do? And identifying with that. If that's spending time in meditation, if that's going for a walk, not for exercise, because I know you love exercise, not for exercise, not for your body, but it's to get your mind connected to why you're doing what you're doing. Because I believe that when you find the reason why you're doing it, it should get you excited about what you do. If it doesn't, I believe you've got to dig a little bit deeper, right? In discovering what it is that you do. Now, on top of that, I've got this concept that I'll explain toward the end. It's about focusing on one day at a time. I have a concept called, that I got from Chip Kelly, who's the coach for the Oregon Ducks. He teaches his players and his coaches to win the day. Win the day. Focus on that one day at a time, but as you win the day, and I'll explain it at the end, figure out what things, what people, what conversations, what activities that you've got to engage in yourself, which is different from mine, it's different from yours, it's different from Chris's, that can help you when you lay your head down at night on the pillow, you can look back upon your day and say, man, I won the day. I found my reason why I'm doing what I'm doing. I'm not looking too far ahead. I've been doing this for 33 years. I'm not going to look 10 years down the road right now. I'm not even going to look at next week right now, because life is short. I don't say that from to get everybody gloomy and worried about what's on the other side, but it should get you excited to know, man, I woke up. Some people can't do what you do. I mean, you're key. Look at the, give this young lady a round of applause. She looks beautiful. She's in shape. So understanding that, man, I get a chance another day to affect somebody's life in my business. Figuring out your reason for why you do what you do. And throughout your day, what are those things that you personally need to connect to, engage in, that make you feel alive? And knowing that you're gonna, as you move, as you wake up, you find your reason, as you move about your day, yeah, you gotta take care of business, but you also know you're gonna get the opportunity to get in the space of those things that make you feel alive. And I'll talk more about that in detail in a few minutes. Okay, we'll talk more. Another question?
Right here. Kevin, I've seen you speak 6 or 8 times, and you're fabulous every time.
Thank you.
And
positive and so upbeat, and even though I've not had tragedies really to feel sorry for myself, we do get down in a pit sometimes. And how, what real tools do you use when you get down there? Because I know you have to go there sometimes.
No doubt.
How do you get out of it? What should we be focusing on or concentrating on to get our mind and our spirit out of that pit? Because the longer we stay there, the harder it is to get out.
And that's such a great question. So I'm going to go there with what I was going to say toward the end. But, you know, I believe it comes down to finding those areas, discovering those areas, putting a label on the areas of your life that are most important to you. We all have a lot of balls that we're juggling in the air. Especially, I don't know if you're married, you've got children, especially the mamas in the room. Let's keep it real. The mamas do so much more than the daddies. I'm just keeping it real now. Hey. I love that. I'm a dad, so I get it. I'm not down in the dads in the room, okay? We juggle so many balls, right? There's so many things that we're juggling in the air. Sometimes it's like, I don't even have enough hands, right? But we've got to identify which of those balls are glass. Which of those balls that we cannot afford to drop? Which of those balls that make us feel whole when we think about those areas? Now, let me pause there for a second. As a communicator, my job is to study life, study people, and most importantly, to have my antennae up every day about my own life and what's working for me. And when I do get down in the doldrums, why am I down there? Right? And then once I come out of that space, that energy, that attitude, that darkness, what are those tools that I use in order to come out? I have to be conscious of that. So that's why I can answer this question. I have six areas that I've identified that are most important to me, and some of you guys have heard this before. Six areas for me personally. There are a lot of areas that we can set goals in, and this is important, that's important, that's important, but what are the balls that you can't drop for me? Family, it's my faith life, it's my fitness life, it's finances, it's future, I've added one, which is fundraising. These are the most important areas of my life right here. Now, okay, I've identified those areas, but what do you do then? I'm just gonna break it down to you. Within a day, when you're down, how do you get back up, right? Start with family. More specific, I've got a daughter that's 19. I've got a son that's 11. I've got another son that's in heaven. I've got a wife of 15 years going on 16. When I say family, yes, I have a brother, a mom, but underneath my roof, those are the people that are most important to me. I have to make sure that every day I connect with my conscious effort, that I connect with my boy. That could be 5 minutes or 50 minutes. That could be one hug and a kiss and an eye contact just to let him know how important he is. That fills me when I'm down. That fills me up. And I know he feels like, because all I wanted from my dad is to feel important, to feel heard. So I make a conscious effort to make sure my boy knows you're special, man, and I love you. I've got to connect with my daughter who now lives in Los Angeles, who's chasing her dreams of dancing, acting, and singing. Whether it be through a text, whether it be her calling me before she goes to an audition, Dad, I'm on my way to an audition, and I say, baby, listen to me. You're 19 and you have the world in your hands. There's greatness in you, best effort. You got me? I got it, Dad. My connection, that's all I need. My wife, we gotta connect, whether it be conversation, whether it be us laughing or something, 10 minutes. Whether it be us sitting back and watching the show, I'll watch The Housewives. I watch it, hey. I'm just letting y'all know. You watch it. And we laugh. But that's our time. That's our connected time, right? I've got to connect with the folks in my family, right? 5 minutes or 50 minutes. Faith life. I have to be able to personally connect with the fact that I'm not just living life every day based upon what I see. I've got to live beyond what I see. I've got to have a dream. I got to stretch out there into the things that I cannot see. Set my goals way out there, and I have to be able to connect with there is a power that's greater than me that I'm connected to. When I feel like, okay, got that faith life, check. That's in the morning when I go for my walk. Third, fitness. I have to get a workout in. If it's going to the gym, if it's going for a run, if it's teaching a class, there is an energy that I need in order for me to get myself back up, to get myself going. These are the things that we were juggling a lot, but family, faith, fitness. I've got to get that workout in. Within that workout, I've got to connect to my favorite music. Whether I'm teaching, whether I'm on a run, when I'm running, I'm singing, man, because I'm connecting with the passion of music, especially when I'm down. And listen, when I'm down, what I notice is I'm not doing these things. I'm not, and I just miss it. Sometimes I just miss the ball, strike three. I'm connecting with the area of fitness, finances. Within my day, I've got to make sure that I've either booked a gig, sent out 30, 40, 50 marketing emails or snail mail. I've got to, maybe I'm speaking that particular day. All those things are connected to my finances. Whether I'm working on a project, a book, a CD series, some sort of program that I'm writing or working on, I've got to connect with that. Why? Because that's what brings in finances for my family. And within that, I want to make sure that what I'm putting together is connected to what I see my future to be, right? And I've got to spend some time within my day doing some sort of fundraising for a cause that's greater than what's going on in my own little world. That's that selflessness part. So I've been a good custodian over my life and figured out how do I make this work for me, but it's winning the day. If I don't connect with those things, I can't lay my head down at night, look back upon my day and say, man, you won today. If I miss something in there, I know that's a lot, but I think that we've got to figure out what people, activities, energy do you personally need to connect to that keep you going, keep your blood flowing. And sometimes when you're down, hey, be there. Hey, I'm down today. It's okay. Sometimes when we're down, we beat ourselves up so much, and that downtime lasts longer when we're beating ourselves up. Know that this is where I'm at, but you have to know, what do I need to do to get myself out of this hole? So it means studying and being conscious of the life that you live, studying and being conscious of the things that make you feel good throughout your day. Hopefully it's not drugs and alcohol and all those other destructive things, but the things that in your life, family, identify those areas first. Within those areas, what do you need to connect to in your daily, on a daily basis, in order for you to win your day? And understand that sometimes you're just down. Let me add to this. Picking up a book for 15 minutes and reading something helps too. Putting a CD of a speaker whose voice that you like and message that you like helps too. You're searching for it. Sometimes none of those work. Sometimes you just have to know. Hard times are not here to stay. Hard times are here to pass. We all have them. And you will go through the roller coaster ride sometimes throughout the year. But if you know what to do to win your day, that helps big time. Because you know what you need to engage in. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Have anybody lost on that?
No. How do I do that?
What's that?
Everything you just said. No, because I thought Terry's question was really spot on. I thought that was a good question, because I failed that. I see myself pretty much every single day I lose my temper at some point. And I see myself, you know John Jones, UFC fighter?
Yes.
Okay, he's a pretty amazing dude. And his one of the things he said is he treats every single person that he talks to, doesn't matter where it's at, he treats them with the utmost respect.
You know what? Sorry to interrupt you, but that's exactly... To me, that's one of the things, too, that I forgot about. When you take your eyes off of you and say, okay, I'm in the doldrums today. But what I'm going to do is anybody within a 5-foot radius, whether I'm pumping gas or whatever it is, I'm going to find a reason to authentically compliment them, whether it be their smile, whether it be their attitude, whether it be service, whatever it is. And as you begin to compliment other people, you come out of the fog, man. Because you're not so focused on your stuff. I have to do that sometimes. You know, I walk in the gym and people know me now. My brand is, he's always positive. No, I'm not. But you just don't know it. So when I walk in the gym, I've got to find a reason to compliment somebody. And when I'm complimenting them and I'm outside of my own stuff, my attitude and that fog begins to lift. Does that make sense? Go ahead, Chris. Sorry about that. You got me excited.
That's kind of something that I know that would be beneficial in my life if I got some tips and something to be more consistent, because I'm not. There'll be, you know, some days I go to a restaurant and I'm just really sweet to the person that's serving me, but that person should deserve that every single time I'm at the restaurant. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Like yesterday, I was talking to my sister. I did an open house yesterday, and there was like 150 people. It was a bit much, and I think I probably came off to a couple people rude, arrogant, cocky. And I wasn't meaning anything by it. It was just
Did you know when you were in the space of doing it, did you feel that this is not really my authentic, this is not the best version of me?
Right when I was done with it, I turned over to Karen, who was there with me, and I was like, that probably looked bad, and I feel bad for it. And I was like trying to justify immediately.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because even if there are some people in the world, Kev, you know this, because like when I look at you and I see you, and probably other people see you, we probably view you like he's perfect. But I know that there's times where you've been ticked off and you probably thought somebody is like not all there mentally, and you're like, come on, I need to get on with my day type of a thing.
Mm-hmm.
I just wanna practice to be less quick to judge,
mm-hmm.
and I wanna be able to appreciate every single human being, because every human being deserves that, you know?
But I don't do a good job at it.
So.
But I think that with that, you have to know that you're human and you're going to have those times. And everybody has those moments. But I think that a lot of times when we lose our temper, we know what people, what situations that cause us to go there, right? For the most part. Now, sometimes it sneaks up on you, right? But I know that there are certain people, like at the time when I was raising, when my daughter is from a previous relationship, and we were raising her together. Her mom lives here in Elk Grove. So I knew coming up that when her and I spoke, we saw things a little bit differently. So what I had to do was grow up and mature and know that when I talk to her, when we're on the phone, and I know potentially this is a person that can get me fired up, I have to consciously enter into that conversation with her, lower in tone and slower in terms of how I say my words, my cadence of my words. Why? Because when I get upset, I'm going to get higher and faster. But if I enter in lower and slower, and if I start to get excited and upset, if I escalate, I'm not escalating overboard where she feels disrespected. I'm escalating at a normal level. But that's a conscious effort, though, to decrease the anger and activate the thinker. Who do I need to be in order to be the best version of me, right? So just, you know that you, half the battle is knowing that you have a challenge with that. So just do the best you can with what you have right where you are and give yourself some room to make mistakes, but consciously work to get better and don't lie to yourself if you're not.
Right.
Piggyback off of Chris's question, patience. I've lost patience.
You're in the wrong business.
Right. I live 5 minutes from here, and it's driving down the road, and there's somebody that's driving slow. I don't know why I'm in such a hurry. I just have lost patience. With. I don't think I ever had it, actually.
That's half the battle.
So,
you know, I think, you know, again, it's because it's conscious, because you know it. I think one of the things you might want to just work on when you wake up in the morning is slowing everything down. Wake up a little bit earlier than you would normally wake up, and just slow everything down, from getting dressed to brushing your teeth to getting to the computer to getting to the office. Start earlier. Start earlier so that you're not rushing. You don't know why, but just start. Give yourself extra 15 minutes tomorrow and just see what happens. Extra 15 minutes. I don't know what you're rushing to. I don't know if it's an appointment. I don't know what the situation is. Yeah.
I don't even know. It's, you know, people
with,
in my mind, everyone's on their Sunday drive. And it's like, No, get out of the way. I gotta get home.
Yeah, we gotta work on that.
It's gonna take some pride of one-on-one.
Yeah, we gotta work on that.
Pills don't even work.
I'm not even getting into that.
What's the rush?
Yeah, what's the rush?
What's that? What's the
I
rush?
I think
Kevin, I think you nailed it.
Time clock?
I'm the same way, is that your day is, or my day, in the very few days I do this, I need to be more consistent, but when you change your cycle and you do something different, like waking up 30 minutes earlier or going to the gym that you normally go to the gym at nighttime, but today I'm going to go to the gym at 6 a.m., your day is completely changed.
Hey, do you work out? We gotta add that. We gotta add that because there is a release. There's a release that working out will help you with. I don't know what it is. I can't even put my hand on it. I just know that once I'm done with a workout, something changes for me.
Yeah.
In my attitude, in my approach, in my gratitude, all of it. So I would specifically say add that to your repertoire.
Okay.
Getting workout, going for a walk. Ride your bike to work. Yes, go ahead.
You know, I want to make a point on that too, that when you work out, you dedicate that 1 hour or whatever it is that you're working out solely to you.
Yes.
And you don't think about work. You don't think about anybody in your family. You are there for you. And it feels so good because you are doing your body a service and you're doing your brain a service.
Absolutely.
And it's powerful.
And I'm not saying, you know, working out to feel, you know, look like everybody looks on the covers of the magazines. Come on, that's just fake anyway. It's, you're doing that for your personal reasons. I need to release. If it's just walking, whatever it is. If you're frustrated in the morning, I would suggest that you get your workout in the morning.
Or maybe not turn on your phone and start checking your emails.
When are your swim classes?
9 a.m. Wednesdays and Fridays, 9 a.m. right over here.
I think Danny would need two workout sessions.
I need two, huh?
Yeah.
Morning and night.
Yeah.
That helps too. I do that sometimes. Yeah. Get a workout in and start earlier. My suggestion. Okay. Anybody else? Right here, Mindy.
So, Kevin, I kind of know a little bit of your story, and you've been through a lot, and you know, you look back at history and all the things that have happened to you, and I have my story, and everybody in this room has their own story.
Yeah.
How have you overcome any trust issues? I mean, it seems like, you know, when you have a lot of that stuff happening to you, it's really hard to trust other people.
Mm.
And then as soon as you start letting that down, somebody else does something else to just kind of put that notch on there again. You feel like justified again to
yes.
not trust.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you overcome that? Because I feel the biggest part with that is not, first you have to trust yourself. And then you have to kind of overcome that. But how do you...
You know, I try to, and this is just, it's an attempt. I think we all, you know, I don't have as many, trust is not one of my issues anymore. But I think that we put people on such a high pedestal to where we don't give them room to be human. They disappoint us so fast, but they're human. You know what I mean? I think for me personally, when I was 25, I stepped into the world of a positive mental attitude. That's when I was given my first book to read and my first audio program to listen to. And for the next 5 years, from 25 to 30, I bombarded my brain with positive words and positive energy, which created a more positive attitude in me and a more positive outlook in life and a more positive view of other people. So I think it has to do with us feeding ourselves the right information on a daily basis and also understanding that people are going to be people. People are going to make mistakes. They're going to be late. They're going to hurt our feelings. All that stuff is going to happen. But knowing that they're not perfect, but neither are we. Giving people room to make mistakes and not just automatically getting so mad because they're not doing it the way we wanted it to be done at the time in which we wanted it to be done. People are going to make mistakes no matter what. I don't care how high we think people are, like on television and rock stars and all this. I went on a tour, on a 19-day tour where we ran across the country. I think I told you guys about that. We did something called Run It Forward, where we ran 2,400 and some odd miles from Chicago to Santa Monica Beach. It was 8 ultra runners, 3 soccer moms, 2 physical therapists, and an empowerment coach. And we were on this tour bus, and we had one rock star. It was Jacoby Shaddix of Papa Roach. Anybody like Papa Roach?
Oh, yeah.
That's my man. So as we were talking in the back of the bus, even he, I mean, he's a rock star. You think he's a rock star. Everything is perfect. He goes, man, our sets, when they put our sets up in for our concerts, they're always messed up. All the time, and I'm thinking to myself, you would think a rock star, you have the money to make everything there on time, doing it right, but even at that level, people making mistakes. So it's about allowing people to be human, but also not judging them because we make mistakes too. Hard to do, but consciously try to put people, we put people so high up, they're people, and all of us are imperfect in some way, shape, or form. Giving people room to be people. Now, I think there's a difference between the professional and relational. But we're not going to go there.
Okay. Kevin, I wanted to thank you for inviting us to your 5K a couple months ago for It Takes Guts.
Yes.
That 5K got me running again, and that has been very impactful on my life and my health and in general,
yes.
And I understand that you wanted to share a little bit about It Takes Guts. Would this be a good time to jump into that?
As we're closing up, before I go there, let me share this. I ran a marathon 2 years ago that I talked about where I almost died. And I told everybody here that I would never run one again. Well, I lied to you. Please forgive me. Give me room to be a liar. I lied. I ran another one this year. And epic weather. It was raining, it was storming, it was crazy cold, I was sick, but I finished. So I've been bitten by the bug to run. I love to run, but what I have to do is I figured out how to multitask when I go to Elk Grove Park. Here's what I do, and this is just something to think about as you're trying to figure out, okay, what things work for me? What are those things that will help me win my day? When I go to Elk Grove Park, I'll run 4 laps is my routine. And I'll have 4 things on my playlist. The first one will be my favorite songs, because I got to connect with those. Second thing will be vocabulary words, because as a speaker, you have to have you want to be able to use the vocabulary that fits the audience that you're speaking to. Another area would be an audio book that I will listen to. And another one would be maybe a professional speaker that I will listen to. So it's 1.44 miles around Elk Grove Park. That first 10 to 12 minutes that it takes me to run, I'm listening to my favorite music, and I'm connecting with that music, and I'm singing, man, I'm having a great time putting myself in a productive zone, excited. I'll stop when I get back to my car for 5 minutes, 10 minutes, take out my BlackBerry, and I'll work on one project, because I'm most creative when I'm running. Work on one project, maybe it's a book I'm working on real quick, I'll put that phone away, and I'll run that second lap and listen to my vocabulary words. I like to add to my body of knowledge. I feel good, I'm listening to vocab, maybe I review 3 or 4 vocabulary words, get to my car, work on that second project, run around again. So I figured out how to multitask, where I'm burning calories, I'm getting my exercise in, I'm getting those endorphins kicking in, and I'm working at the same time. So sometimes you can integrate it all together. So think about that too. In terms of It Takes Guts, my wife started a foundation. We were big supporters of March of Dimes for so many years, because March of Dimes created this medication, this surfactant, that kept Kobe's lungs from sticking together, which is one reason why he's here today. But we had to go a little bit deeper, because Kobe since has been diagnosed with something called PSC, primary sclerosing cholangitis. And he's been diagnosed because they were trying to help him with his, colitis and all these other things, to where he's been diagnosed with a seemingly incurable liver disease. So we had to get more detailed in our focus, more detailed in our fundraising. So what we're doing now is fundraising for children who have been diagnosed with a rare autoimmune disease. And we're raising money because this disease is a small, very small percentage of adults have been diagnosed with this disease. And it's an even smaller percentage of young people, children that have been diagnosed with this disease. And doctors aren't doing a lot of research right now because there's no money in it. Such a small percentage of people who have it, so why are we gonna spend our time with this? So we have to continue to raise the money, like $100,000 a year, to keep a doctor who we've met in San Diego, to keep him doing research so that families, as these kids are born, these premature kids are born, that we can figure out why are they getting this primary sclerosing cholangitis? Why are they getting this rare autoimmune disease? So my wife and a friend of hers by the name of Tammy created this nonprofit called It Takes Guts. And we do run, we do the 5K run. Les Brown came recently and we did a fundraiser at a church in downtown. And our next fundraiser is gonna be May 18th at the Monstars of Motivation show. I don't know, has anybody here been in a Monstars before? You've been to a Monstars show, a few of you? I'm hoping once I get the flyers, I'll be posting them, giving them to Chris. I know you guys, and thankfully you're purchasing 50 tickets, so you guys can actually come. I want you to come out on May 18th. We're not just hanging out. We're there to motivate, we're there to inspire, we're there to infuse the community with hopes and dreams and greatness, while at the same time raising money for It Takes Guts for kids who have been diagnosed with this disease. So I think there's a video that we're gonna play really quickly as we close out.
Tell everyone that was your son.
That's my son, Kobe. That's Kobe right there. And another young lady by the name of Madeline.
Thanks, Justin.
those kids were a small percentage of kids in our area that have been diagnosed with this rare autoimmune disease, and we're fighting for them. We're fighting for them because these kids are in, you know, chronic pain, and tomorrow I'm going to ask for your prayer, 7:50 a.m. We're going. We have a surgery in the morning at 7:50. I need your prayers. Kobe, Jess, myself, my family, we appreciate your prayers, and we just gotta keep fighting the battle, you know? And we're gonna win. We're gonna win. And the last thing I want to tell you guys is, it's all about controlling your mind every single day. It's all about the Muhammad Ali mentality. Is you can't give mental recognition to the possibility of failure, doubt, or defeat. You gotta fight the negative thoughts that go through your mind every single day. When your mind goes negative, you gotta open up your mouth and devour the negative. By speaking out positive words, find these phrases and the things that we post on Facebook and we tweet out. We're living in a quote world where quotes seem to be watered down now because everybody's putting up quotes. But find the ones that work for you and memorize those. And when your mind goes negative, you gotta speak out. Repeat this after me, please. There's greatness.
In me.
You gotta find series of quotes to help keep the negative out of your mind. Because we live in a negative world, it will beat you up if you let it, but you don't have to let the negative thoughts fester. You gotta be talking to yourself constantly. This is what I do in order to try to stay out of the doldrums. So the Muhammad Ali mentality, do not give mental recognition to the possibility of failure. Every day, doubt. Every day, defeat. Every day. Will you win every day? No, it's not even realistic to win every day. But just do the best you can with what you have. Right where you are, because I personally believe, my friend, there's greatness in you. But focus on winning the day. Stop looking so far down the road. It's the moment. It's the day. Figure out the areas, those five or six areas that are most valuable to you, and what people, what connections, what energy do you need to step into to stay in that zone of productivity. If that makes sense, say that makes sense.
That makes sense.
Till next time, this has been Kendra, Kobe, and Caleb's daddy, and Jessica's husband. Also known to my family and friends, and in my own mind, as the Muhammad Ali of motivation. Telling you, repeat this after me, please, again. There's greatness.
In me.
Shake somebody's hand on your right and your left and say, he's talking to you.
Thank you
very much.
Talking to you.
What's the rush?